World. That crazy ballyhoo at Disney World. Our movies are magic, our cameras are rolling, the stars, they're gonna be here. And any man or child can take the stage. It doesn't matter what your age, you're in for Disney World and our Disney MGM studios, where any one of you from near and far could be a star. Come on and have some fun. Chillicothe's and the Dukas to catch the excitement and get their name up in lights. Mommies and daddies, all the young kiddies, movie magic is such a wonderful sight. Hooray for Disney World, you'll see the greatest stars of yesterday. And if you think that you can be an actor, you'll be an actor, you won't have to wait.
thrilled to have Bette Miller be here to dedicate this fabulous tour. Is a wonderful opportunity and thrill for the Walt Disney Company.
This studio tour that is being dedicated today is so complete that most everyone that goes through it will probably qualify for a Guild card at the end of it. I'm very, very proud to have been associated with a company that provides such marvelous opportunity for so many artisans and so many artists to do their best level of work. And I would just want to say to all of them and to Michael and Jeffrey, thanks for the opportunity, and I wish them all greatest success with this most new and exciting adventure here at Walt Disney World. Let's dedicate!
On this 29th day of April 1989, we dedicate the Disney MGM Studios Backstage Tour. Lights, camera, action!
Check. If you can hear me, wave to me. Okay, great. I know you folks in the front car can hear me. And behind us at the wheel of the shuttle this morning, we have Steve. Hey, Steve.
Hi, Diane. Welcome aboard, everyone.
And Steve is going to be steering us behind the scenes of a working movie television production center. What we're doing right now, we're just waiting for the all clear from Mission Control, and then we'll be on our way. In the meantime, just sit back and relax. You might want to check those cameras. Make sure you have enough film in there. And don't forget, take the caps off the lens.
We'd like to welcome you to our Disney MGM Studios, where we have sound stages, outdoor sets. You know, you might be lucky enough to get to see a crew actually filming, in which case we're going to ask you not to take films. But in the meantime, shoot away, all right? As you see it, it's two mouse ears, right? Now, the hat size, they tell me, is 342 3/8. That's quite a big head.
Now, still off to the right, a little bit lower to the ground, you notice some cars parked there in our prop storage warehouse area. Well, the two futuristic vehicles that you see are from Blade Runner. The red car is the Coyote from Hardcastle and McCormick. and the classic black car with green spokes. Well, that was used in The Untouchables with Sean Connery and Kevin Costner. A little bit farther ahead, you can see some colorful vintage cars, such as the yellow car, the red car. Well, all of these cars along in here were used in the filming of Dick Tracy. Right across the street, though, you see our bungalow building. And a bungalow building houses our production crews when they're filming here at the studios. Currently, you can see in bungalow number 3, we have the Mickey Mouse Club, and this is their permanent home here at the studios. If you go on our sister tour inside the Magic Special Effects and Production Tour, you'll see on soundstage number 1, their standing sets, and actually, you might even get to see them today because they are filming today and the rest of the week through Saturday. Right now, though, we've steered into a small branch of our greens department. Now, greenery is often used to hide what the camera is not supposed to see. Say, for example, we've only built a small portion of a set. Well, we can use some of the bushes and trees along in here to hide that fact. Now, notice all of our greenery is planted in portable boxes, and that allows us easy transportation to wherever we're going to be using the greenery. Now, even in our greens department, we have our own cast of characters. And they're coming up on our right. You can see our elephant and our toy soldier. Well, these sculpture figures are known as topiaries. Now, they can take up to 10 years to fully develop. And when they do fully develop, they'll join the more than 160 topiaries located across Walt Disney World properties. Now, laying on the ground is the large flower stem. You might recognize that from the large flower stem in the movie Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. Right now, though, we're going inside to one of our more glamorous departments on the tour, and that is the world of creative costuming. Now, everything will be coming up on your left, so do continue looking off to your left. Now, in here, you'll see just some of the 180 artists as they design and manufacture costumes for our television and entertainment needs. It all begins with a designer sketch. You can see some of those along the far back wall. Those are then turned down to our seamstresses and tailors.
Now, just beyond costume, you're going to see the lighting department, small props, camera, and our scenic department. Here in the lighting department, we can provide up to 3.5 million watts of light for film and video production on and off this set. Now, they tally, that's enough power to light the entire city of Orlando. And then right next to that, you're going to see some special effects makeup that was used in the Dick Tracy movie, 45 different masks. By the way, that movie was released on June 15th. And then our small props department. We find these small props in antique shows, flea markets. We might have been ordering yard sales or garage sales looking for something. If we can't find it, we'll build it. Then the camera department, where the technicians maintain all this film and video equipment tools actually needed on and off the set. Last but certainly not least, we have our scenic department. Now this is where the carpenters, they begin construction on a set that they later finish up on a soundstage. And believe me, they're very talented people. They built a 40-foot wooden submarine for a rock video. They also built a giant turntable for the Mickey Mouse Club. Right now what they're working on sets for the Mickey Mouse Club. Now a standing set, that's a set that gets used over and over again. It can be as simple as one room or as elaborate as the entire house. And in just a few minutes, we're going to be visiting some really unusual houses. On your right, look at that rather unique set. That's a Delta L-211 jet and its custom-made hangar. The jet has been featured in 2 major movies. One was Quick Change. Then Wesley Snipes was here during Passenger 57. In fact, he did film the entire movie in the Central Florida area.
Now, when production crews travel to cities or towns to film on location, well, they often run into problems they have little or no control over. Things like crowds, traffic, and noise. Well, to get around these problems, they often prefer to shoot on what is known as a studio backlot. Now, this portion of our backlot is known as Residential Street. And we do have a lot of nice homes here. This is quite a nice neighborhood. But take a good look at all of the homes, especially the first house coming up on our right, the old colonial-style home. You'll begin to see why you wouldn't want to move into any one of these homes. Now, our next home here is from the Touchstone Pictures comedy Ernest Saves Christmas there, starring Jim Varney. That was Vern's house in that movie.
Oh, what's that? Herbie. Everybody say hi to Herbie.
How are you doing, huh?
I think he still has that acting bug, huh? Well, like I was telling you, that yellow house, it's right.
But right across the street, you'll see a white Miami-style home, and in the carport, you'll notice a 1963 classic Cadillac. Well, that car was used in the movie Tin Man with Richard Dreyfuss and Danny DeVito. Now, along Residential Street, you'll see 7 different architectural styles of homes. that allows us to film at any one of these homes. It could be anywhere in the United States. Now, we do have one famous home here on Resident Street, and it is coming up to your left. It's the beige contemporary Hawaiian-style home, the home with all the ferns in the front. Well, it is the television home to the Golden Girls. Now, the exterior of the house is shot right here and then edited together with the interior shots filmed on a soundstage in California. When you put the two together, we have a show that airs on Saturday night on NBC. Now, when a home has been selected for a shoot, set designers like to give it that lived-in look by adding different set dressings. This last blue house, they've done just that. They've taken one end of the house, and they've aged it to make it look like it's been there for many, many years. But the other side, well, it's well-kept, and it has different things like the flag, the basketball net, bicycle. All those things give it that lived-in look. Tells you a lot about a family that's supposed to live there. It doesn't really live there at all. Now here at the end of Residential Street, off to your right, you can see the Bulldog Cafe. It's quite a strange structure. It's a California crazy structure, but it is from the upcoming movie Rocketeer, and that does premiere right here in Central Florida Friday night at the AMC Theaters. We have a special showing of it tomorrow night, still over on Pleasure Island at AMC, so do check that out. And you can see the Bulldog Cafe in that movie. Right up ahead, you see New York City there. And that is where the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles do make their appearances daily. You can certainly check your Showtime guide for their next appearance. I think they're due out at 2 o'clock. And I can tell you how you can go out there and join them at the end of our tour. But right now we're taking you to a part of our backlot called a boneyard. And a boneyard is like a big outdoor attic. It's where we store large-scale props that have been used previously in other movies. You'll find things here like boats, spaceship, cars, planes, most anything that was used as a large-scale prop. You can see this large black boat here. Well, this was used in the 100 Lives of Blackjack Savage. Now, that has been clocked speeds of over 70 miles an hour, quite fast there. You can also see some Army vehicles. These were used as set dressings for our own Indiana Jones Epic Stunt Spectacular. You can also see a tail section of an airplane wedged right in there. Well, that's the tail section of the airplane from the goodbye scene in Casablanca. I'm sure you all remember that there. The front half of that plane is in the Casablanca scene over at the great movie ride, the Chinese Theater. Coming up, you can begin to see three blue vehicles. Well, these were each used in the filming of Who Framed Roger Rabbit. You remember Roger did get in that car and drive in that movie. Well, a toon certainly doesn't know how to drive, and you can see what happens. That last car looks like a convertible. That's the one that Roger did drive there. Our Pacific Electric trolley car here, well, take a good look at it. It's not really a trolley car. That was also used in Who Framed Roger Rabbit, but that's a modified city bus, and behind those fiberglass trolley wheels, you might get to see some of those bus wheels. See, we can drive a bus a lot easier around a back lot versus a trolley car. It certainly saves us time and money. We don't have to lay track down every time we want to move that trolley car. The two silver space pods that you see are from the 1986 film Flight of the Navigator. The one with the opening that's used for ground flights, or ground sequences, excuse me, and the second one is all enclosed, and that is used for mid-flight scenes there. The gears are from the final scene in Dick Tracy, but take a look past all of those. You can see inside the homes on Residential Street. You remember from the front, they certainly look like a true house, but from the back, you see we only need to build what the camera needs to see. That's why the sides of the homes and the shingles on the roof stop just beyond camera range. But say we need to build something that we can't find in Central Florida. Maybe an active oil field in a dry, barren desert. Well, you know, we don't have that here in Orlando, so we built one right here on our back lot. Now, we're going to be able to go right up inside of that today. We're going to experience some of the special effects that we have in there. So you want to make sure you keep your seats and hold on to those cameras nice and tight. We are driving over a bumpy old bridge. I will point out some of the things once we get in there. We actually will stop so you can take some pictures. I think we're just waiting on our final clearance, and then we will go right on out. All right, looks like Andy's taking us right up inside the canyon. Now, this particular canyon took over 6 months to build. That is quite long for just one particular set. It was modeled after Shoot Canyon in California. Once we do get inside, I think you'll understand why. You begin to see, actually, why it did take us so long to build this particular set.
So when they got the oil tanker in here, they had to hoist it over the canyon with a large crane because we don't have a road here. They couldn't drive it in. Now, what I'm hoping we'll get to see, like I said, the rain sequence. The way they created that for this particular movie, the shuttle itself, we're parked underneath a large ledge. High above that ledge, just right out of camera range, they have this huge, powerful sprinkler system that they have turned upside down. Now, the reason why they turned it upside down is when they turn it on, it gives you the swirling effect like the wind is blowing through the rain instead of coming straight down. Oh, great, there it goes. Now, look at the top of the oil tanker. See, that rain is barely touching that. It's not covering the entire set. It's just a couple feet deep. Wait a minute. Steve, I think that truck started up. That's not supposed to happen. Wait a minute, I think that just caused it. What's that? They're filming in here. Steve, you better get on the phone. Just stay seated.
They often film at our hotels, they'll go to our tree farms, and even on occasion, they've gone to Epcot Center, the World Showcase, for overseas locations. For you folks that were on the wrong side to take any photos of the Boneyard, we're passing it again, so this is a good opportunity. Uh-oh, we're getting ready to pass another shuttle. Now let's not run the surprise, like don't say go back or you're gonna get wet or all this stuff. Just be friendly, smile, wave to them if you feel like it, but don't say anything. And you folks on the left, try and look a little dry. Now, as Steve makes this turn, let's take a look at the backlot church again. The side facing this looks like a small country church, but in reality, we have two churches on that one corner. The front of the church fits the big city row, but that's perfect because remember where I said we're gone to New York. And this is the studios. Well, it's a little slice of the Big Apple. Take another look to the right in the town hall here. See how that building's being held up, a steel structure? Well, every one of the buildings on New York Street, they're all being held up like that. And of course, being a resident of Florida, I had to ask the first question. What if we had a hurricane? Well, they assured me that they are not buildings. They are painted flats. This is an old movie trick we call forced perspective. It makes the buildings look a lot taller than what they really are. The real Empire State Building is over 100 stories tall. Ours is just a little over 4 stories. You'll get a second opportunity on the way out of New York Street for another photo. And coming up on your left, here's original Diffleville from Who Framed Roger Rabbit. If we have any tents on bar, I highly suggest you better duck. Who's driving that truck? Look, there's somebody behind the wheel. Huh.
Very clever, that.
You know, we could make New York Street look like any large city across the United States. You're probably saying, oh, sure you can. Sure you can. Every large city has the Empire State Building and the Chrysler Building. Hey, we don't have a problem with that because we can reboot both of them. We can make it look like this. Just by removing some of the street lights, parking different cars. Take a look at the theater to your left. Now, that looks like something from out of the 1940s. When Dick Tracy and his crime stoppers were in their heyday.
And this time, once again, for Dick Tracy's crime stoppers.
Doing that time. That time.
You know, it was one of those long, hot days when all the women hung
surprises. What fingers that thing? Pulling a jewelry heist. Bad luck stuck at him like gum on your shoe. Lightfingers was too busy picking up the goods to notice Officer Maloney getting a drop on him. Maloney shouted, "Freeze, mister." Lightfingers stood straight up and knocked Maloney off balance. He took off running. Maloney fired a warning shot and shouted, "Drop it!" But Lightfingers wasn't going to give up easy. He pulled the bolt on his Thompson submachine gun. Pointing it at an innocent passerby, he shouted, "One move now, and the day gets it." Maloney pleaded, "No, don't do it." Lightfingers answered, "You asked for it." And he pulled the trigger. Lightfingers looked just like that. Officer Maloney saved the jewels, but he couldn't save Lightfingers.
Tune in again next time for another exciting adventure of Dick Tracy's Crime Stoppers.
And now, it's time once again for Dick Tracy's Crime Stoppers.
It was a hot summer day in the city. The kind of a day when your shoes melt into the pavement if you stand in one place too long. But he wasn't thinking of the heat when the four eyes knew when he stepped out of the corner diner. He was one of Big Boy Caprice's favorites. Four Eyes specialized in explosives. As he walked, Four Eyes touched a suspicious package under his arm. Before long, he was near the station house on 8th Street. Most criminals would never come as close to a police station voluntarily. But Four Eyes didn't care. He had a score to set. It was clear he was up to no good. About that time, Officer Sweeney stepped out of the station. He was headed for his squad car to begin his patrol. Immediately, he noticed Four Eyes lingering by the hood and called for him to halt. Always ready for trouble, Four Eyes lets his .38 for him. Officer Sweeney threw his service revolver and fired back. Realizing his time was short, Four Eyes makes a break for it. Sweeney followed close behind. Hearing the ticking sound from under the hood, Officer Sweeney knew that every citizen was in danger. He blew his whistle and shouted for everyone to get out of the area. Officer Sweeney couldn't save his squad car, but he did put Four Eyes where he belongs, behind bars.
Tune in again next time for another exciting adventure of Dick Tracy's Crime Stoppers.
As you can see, almost anything can happen on the back lot. Believe me, it does. Now, as we pass a little plaque again on your right-hand side, if there's anyone on the shuttle from New York, take a really close look at that archway, because it should look familiar. The gateway to Washington Square in Greenwich Village. Up there on the hillside where the battle van is, that's the beginning of part two. And like I said, you pick that up at your convenience. Every 3.5 minutes, we have one leaving. Just remain seated till the vehicle comes to complete stop and the doors are all the way open.
monitors. As you can understand, now we leave the water surface flat and our miniature looks fake, so we add some waves. But if our waves are too big, our miniature ends up looking like a toy in the bathtub. To get around these problems, we use very large fans to create very small but fast-moving waves. Then we slow everything down to give it the proper scale. By adding smoke, music, and sound effects, our battle sequence is almost complete. We just need two more things. Explosions, like that one, provided by water cannons, and a rather unsuspecting volunteer from our audience. Hi there, sir. What's your name?
Phil Smith.
Well, Phil, today you're going to be Captain Duck, commander of the SS Totally Sinkable. In our action-packed adventure, all hands on deck, Phil. While I'm patrolling the deepest, darkest regions of our special effects tank, you spot a battleship off in the distance. Over this way, Phil, and fire a torpedo straight through our midships. Fire! Oh, good shot. Unfortunately, it was one of ours. Oh, no, what have you done? Enemy plane commands have flown!
Sculptures are made and used as guides to create full-size mechanical props. Some creatures work like puppets with off-camera operators using cables to move them. In other cases, miniatures are brought to life through a process called stop-motion animation. In this technique, the model is photographed one frame at a time, and the animator comes in and moves the figure slightly between each shot. When the film is projected back at normal speed, the movement looks very lifelike, as with the scorpion from Honey by Shrek the Kids. That's a Lego block he's attacking. Oh, miniatures play a big part in special effects. Miss Darwin and Ferryboat are two of the miniatures from Dick Tracy, a film that has taken the art of visual effects to a new level. Watch those monitors and I'll show you what I mean. This scene involved four elements: miniatures, live action, animation, and something we call a matte painting. How did they come together? Visual effects. Here's how they were all used to create Tracy Town. First, the live action was filmed in front of a painted flat on the studio backlot, and Warren Beatty has chased the kid along 100 feet of fake railroad tracks. Then 6,000 hours of labor went into building a one-ton model train and a detailed miniature set with just the right lighting. The timing of the miniature locomotive and the live actors had to match, so the steam train was powered by a computer-driven cable system, which allowed it to run at various speeds. That square rake you see in front of the camera lens is actually a mirror. By placing it over the tracks, the image of the oncoming train can be reflected right back into the camera lens, and on film it looks like a head-on collision. Next to filming the rest of the scene, a matte painting was created by what is called a key illustration. The film of the live action and the miniatures was projected onto a large sheet of glass, and the big city background was painted in all around it. Finally, animated twinkling stars, flashing neon signs, and colored smoke were added to complete the shot. All this for a scene that only lasts 11 seconds. No wonder Dick Tracy looks so bewildered. Well, as you can see in the world of special effects, when you combine a little imagination with just a little technical know-how, almost anything can happen. See what I mean? This is Auntie from Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. I think she said they can go in now. Go in where, Auntie? Thanks. To our special effects shooting stage, that's the next stop on your tour. For those of you in front of me, could you please exit to your left? Enjoy the rest of your tour, everyone.
Used to make people or objects appear someplace they're not. By filming in front of a blue screen, later we could make the blue disappear and replace it with any background that we like. It was this process that enabled actor Bob Hoskins to drop into the cartoon world of Roger Rabbit.
Now, as you can see, we remain quite stationary on the studio floor, but thanks to our control camera, which stands tilts and zooms, we have the illusion of flight over your monitors. And sir, can we set up for another shot?
Okay.
Talking about actors. Guys, action was great and fabulous. But I said this was supposed to be a scary scene. I looked up, you guys were smiling. So we're going to change the scene up and make it a little more dramatic. This time, PJ, you're going to pretend like you're falling off the side of the beat. But you don't want that to happen. So you're going to reach up with your left arm. Aaron's going to reach down with his right arm, grab you, and dramatically save your life. Aaron's still smiling. Camera's ready. And action! Reach up, Aaron, reach down. Folks, we're delivering a terror on those faces. And that's a wrap. Now, the original motion picture, all these elements were shot in some form of film, but today we're using video so you can see the results right away. Take a look up at your monitors, we'll play back the completed scene just like you see it at the movies.
Thumbs up from down here, folks. How about a big round of applause?
the stars. Again.
I hate melons.
Hey. Oh. Yikes! I won the lottery! New York! New York! Guess what? I won the lottery! I'm taking y'all to lunch! Oh. My fortune! My freedom! Stay right there. Don't move.
Now take her and I'll buy your own statue in the parlor.
That lady is gonna fall!
I'm not gonna fall. I refuse to fall.
Come here, you little feather ball.
I'll show you how it's really done.
The magic of movie making has more to do with illusion than reality. For instance, Beth's apartment was built in a soundstage here at our studios. All those street scenes weren't really filmed in New York City. They were done on our own backlot version of New York Street. When Beth climbs outside the window, it's really stunt double Carol Nielsen in a matching costume and wig. Back on the soundstage, we recreated the entire apartment. Watch out, Beth! This death-defying drop takes Beth to a foam mattress 2 feet down. Back outside, it's stunt woman Carol hanging on for dear life. Don't worry, though. She's wearing a safety harness underneath her costume. Beth hangs in front of a blue screen so we can superimpose her over the New York City skyline. The banner fall is a series of shots using both Beth and Carol. Before this next complicated scene is filmed, director Gary Marshall makes sure that everyone knows the plan. And then it's time for one of the wildest rides ever down the sidewalks of New York. That shopping cart is controlled on a track. But some things just require the human touch.
Whoa!
The subway stair sequence begins on the New York Street back lot and finishes inside on our sound stage. Remember the flight over the turnstile? That uses a compressed air catapult. Even though they fall apart, these aren't cheap shoes. The heels are just made of wax. And that fearsome subway train isn't what it appears to be either. But at least the crew makes sure it arrives on time. The final movie you saw today was just 2.5 minutes long, but it took a crew of nearly 100 people 5 days to shoot. That's the reality, but we believe the illusion was worth it.
I feel like the illusion was
well worth it. How's that for movie-making magic? Now let's go down to the soundstage floor where y'all can take pictures of the process that's used in the making of Lottery.
Thank you. And as I was saying, the last thing we'll show you is about dialogue replacement.
Well, I guess we're nearly through, huh, Pee Wee?
I know you are, but what am I?
Hey, where's my voice?
I don't know. Where?
Give me back my voice!
What's the matter? I love my voice.
Why don't you marry it?
Why don't you make me, Mel? You're already made, and what a mess.
So funny, I almost forgot to laugh.
Say it, don't spray it.
You know, Mel, why don't you show a little maturity?
It's easy for you to say!
Hello, I'm Michael Eisner, head of the Walt Disney Company. In just a few moments, we're going to begin our Disney special. You know, I remember so clearly the first time I saw a Disney film. It was a sunny Tuesday in New York. No, it was a Thursday. Maybe it was raining.
Michael, guess who?
Donald Duck.
Fooled ya! Hi, Michael.
Hi, Mickey, and I knew it was you all the time.
Oh, sorry, Michael, but we have a screening to go to, remember?
That's right. Look what time it is.
Yeah, I know. We're going to be late if we don't hurry.
Mickey and I are going to a screening. Why don't you folks come along?
Hey, good idea. We're going to look at a swell show called The Best of Disney. Come on. Easy, big fella. Hey, Michael, wait for me. After you.
Thanks, Mickey.
Hi, Michael.
Hi there.
Hi, Mickey.
Oh, hi.
Just a second, Mickey. Let me grab these guys.
Okay.
Excuse me. We're about to start the screening. If you'd like to join us.
Come on.
Go. Screening time. Go, guys. Movie time.
Come on, fellas. Screening. My favorite seat. Excuse me. Do you mind?
Excuse me. Will you sit down, please? You're blocking our view.
Ooh. Sorry, Mr. Eisner. Excuse me. It'll never happen again.
Thanks.
Roll it.